figure out, we're trying to model the growth rate of whatever it is we're talking about, y, whatever that y is. And we're using time to model it. So we know this is just some straight line. But we know that most of our growth rates don't occur in perfectly linear fashion. For example, when we did this, we modeled that as a straight line to measure the growth rate. U are all the other factors that affect the growth rate that we haven't modeled. The things that are left out of the model, or things that are unknown from the model. It's an error term. It's an unknown variable. It's not that important, at least not yet. We're not going to talk too much about it, other than the fact that whenever we write out a regression equation, we're always going to put that U there. Just to remind us that we don't have too many things that actually behave in perfectly straight lines. There aren't too many things that actually behave in perfectly straight lines. And we need to be able to at least acknowledge that there are things other than time that are causing something to grow. And that's all that U is. So don't worry too much about it. It disappears in the regression output, but technically we need to have it. So it's not that important. So don't get confused. Yeah?
So would you be like what you do to the company's effective growth rate? Is that in essence what you're saying?
U stands for unknown. It's all the other stuff that's unknown that's causing fluctuations. We know some of those fluctuations are caused by seasonality, and we can model those things, but we don't necessarily need to do, even when we model that, we're not going to be able to model things perfectly. So all the U does is acknowledge that we can't know everything about something. That's really what it is. It's an acknowledgement that we don't know, we can't explain something 100%. Unknown random factors that occur all the time. Just strange things happen. All right. So we have this simple trend that we've been working with. And pictorially, again, it's nothing more than a straight line. So all I do is call x1 time. And that's our linear trend. But we knew all this. We've done all this. We know that beta 0 is the y-intercept. It represents the value of y when x equals 0. And that was true in 6th grade or 8th grade or whenever it is we learned about straight lines. That's true today. The y-intercept is still the value of y when x equals 0. Which is one of the reasons I like to create that time trend. Because remember when we created that time trend, variable time, time equals underscore n, it creates a time trend that goes 1 through whatever. When we use the date function, that date function is the number of days since 1960, January 1st, 1960. So 0, if we use the date function, 0 represents the number of days since 1960, or represents January 1st, 1960. And we don't really know or care what happened on January 1st, 1960. What we do care is what happens at the beginning of our data set. That's why that time frame makes sense. Otherwise, we've got, think about using years. If we were using years, I would say the same thing. And use a time trend. Why? Because if we had years in here, if x was years, we'd still be able to say, our sales change for each year, but our y-intercept, beta zero, would represent sales in what year?
The first year.
What year?
1987.
Think about sixth grade. The y-intercept is the value of y when x equals zero. What is the y-intercept when we use years as?
Wouldn't that be the end of the first year?
1960. Nope. If we're using the years, just the number year, 1999.
Beginning of time?
It would be the year zero.
Year zero.
Exactly. We'd be looking at sales when Jesus was born. Theoretically. Or can see, yeah, when Jesus was riding a dinosaur.
Yes.
It doesn't make any sense. That's why the linear time trend makes sense, because we start at one, and zero is the first, could be the first year of the data, or the year before the data. So we don't have to extrapolate all the way to year zero. So we'd still get the same slope coefficient, but the beta would be this weird thing that represented sales when year was equal to zero. And that's just counterintuitive. Does that make sense? That's why that time trend makes sense to use. Beta zero has the same interpretation as it did in sixth grade. It's the y-intercept, the value of y when x equals zero. In this case, x is time. It's the value of y when time is equal to zero. And remember, most of our data sets are not going to start at year zero. They're going to start in 2000 or 1995 or something. We don't care about year zero. That's why that constructing that time trend makes sense. And our slope is beta one. This is the same graph you would have in the sixth grade, except we got fancy notation. And we know that our interpretation when we use log y's is the percentage change per period or growth rate per period. And that's the beauty of using logs. But if we didn't use logs, we'd still get a growth rate. It would just be a unit growth rate per period. How many cases we're selling each year on average? We're comfortable with this? This is good?
Yeah.
What we may want to do is analyze events. How do events change our growth rate? So this assumes we have some constant trend throughout the data. But let's say that we have, we start engaging in advertising. Or let's say your firm, or your winery, or whatever, wherever it is you work, decides that they've, you know, after reading all the press and going to all the marketing conferences, and hearing over and over and over, that you have to be what? Your firm has to be, your winery has to be what?
Profitable.
We gotta be profitable, but how do we be, how are you profitable now in 2015? You gotta be on social media. You gotta be online. You gotta hire a social media manager. You gotta hire someone to go out there and interact with your customers.
You gotta be connected.
You gotta be on Twitter. You gotta be on Facebook. You gotta have, and you gotta pay someone to do all this stuff to interact. And you gotta do it. I mean, I go to all these marketing conferences, and I've heard this a million times. At every one, there's a social media session, and they say the same thing. If you're not on social media, and your competitors are, they're taking your business. You're losing money. Are we all? Okay. And you have any proof? Oh, that's what we do. We measure effects. So, you're telling me that here are my sales, here's time, and here is some pre-period, and here's some post-period. This is pre-social media, and this is post-social media. You're telling me that here are my sales, I'll calculate the growth rate, we'll take logs, calculate, we'll outreg it and get these nice tables and calculate the compounded growth rate and do all that kind of good stuff. But if you're right, if all those marketing experts are right, I hire a social media person, probably one of the people that are at those conferences telling you you need to hire a social media person, because they'll be passing out their cards a bit. According to them, what's going to happen? To happen. We want to be able to measure that. That's it. But it requires a little bit more. In essence, we want to see if this slope is different than that slope. We're still calculating slopes. We're still going to run log regressions. We're still going to do all these things, but now we're going to have some pre and post period that we want to measure. You said I got to be on social media. I just paid you $100,000 to be my social media manager. Anyone remember the what was it? Good Murphy Good? Yeah. The competition? Yeah. Well, you've all heard of Murphy Good wine. We had a competition for a social media manager. And people from all the, it was a worldwide competition, and you had to send in your a videotape, which tells you how long ago this was, about 10, 15 years ago, I think now. No, about 10 years ago. You had to send in a videotape saying why they should hire you as their social media manager. The winner got paid $100,000 and got to live on the vineyard estate for free. Pretty good deal. But this is how much they believe social media is going to do that. And the only reason you're going to hire a social media manager is the only reason you would hire your an advertiser, you know, promotions and all those things, because you expect to get a return on investment. That's it. All we want to do is to be able to measure that. Can we do this in a systematic fashion so that we can say, yeah, growth rate was 5% here, and now it's 8% there. Can we do that? Yeah, we can. And that's what we're going to do.
Do you have some data on this?
Yes.
Nice.
And we're not going to deal with the social media stuff just yet. We're going to do that a little bit later because it's a little bit more complex. And I'll talk about it. But I've presented that at a couple of social media conferences, and you wouldn't believe the hatred I get. You guys think you hate me. You should see me at a social media conference telling them that social media is junk.
Oh, I hate to jump to the end of it, but see, that's what your side's about.
No, that's not. I don't want to give that anything.
Oh, okay.
So you're essentially showing how marketing works.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So we want to see if marketing has an effect, whether it's social media or any other kind of marketing or promotional activities. Now we're going to read a really, really famous paper by a really, really famous author. But we'll get to that in a minute. Well, let's get the mechanics down. All right, any questions? This seems reasonable, right? This is, you absolutely have to do this. If you're going to hire someone to do something, you want to see the effect of that. It's simple ROI. What did I get for my money? That's it. So I said at the beginning of the class, if you think we're doing something that's useless or that's PhD stuff that none of us are ever gonna do. This is whether you're finance or marketing or whatever, and you probably, this is one of the things you should, you probably shouldn't have marketing determine their own ROI. Which is who usually does this. You probably want finance to do this or someone else. That's like asking you over. How do you think I did?
Oh, I did awesome.
Ask my mom. She agrees. All right, so how do we do this? Analyzing trends before and after an event. We got our starting model. We're good with this. And let's go back a second. Remember when we analyzed the benchmarks? When we were constructing that benchmark, we had we had that seasonality, right? But we had that straight line. And we said the straight line doesn't pick up the seasonality, and we wanted that seasonality. And we tried moving averages and monthly averages. And what we wanted, the monthly average was flat, but we got the seasonality. The trend got the trend, but missed the seasonality. And we needed to combine those two. So we created that thing called the thing that caused the line to shift up. Remember in December, it modeled the December, and we did it for January. Dummy variable. And what a dummy variable is really, it's a shifter. It allows the regression line, the straight line, to shift up to match the data. And that's all a dummy variable does. And we constructed one minus the number of months. We constructed love with 11 of them, one for each month, and then the admitted category. So we're going to use dummy variables again. All right. And we know what a dummy variable was. Well, let's see how the PowerPoint goes. Add a variable that indicates before and after an event. So we're going to add a variable called X2. Remember we created the variable December equals 1 if December, 0 if not. This is the same thing. X2 is going to be 1, it doesn't matter if it's before or after, I don't know, we're just going to have 1 if after, and 0 if before. Before what? The event. Remember we got time, so we'll know the date that you hired that social media manager. We'll know that date. That's our pre and post. That's our before and after. So this is pretty easy, right? This is, make up the date. This is 5/9/13. I don't know what that means, but on May 9th, 2013, we hired a social media manager. So what is one? I'm sorry, what is X2? X2 is one if our date is past 5/9/13. And it's gonna be one for all those dates. Before 5/9/13, what's X2 gonna be?
Zero.
X2 is gonna have no effect on anything before. It's only gonna matter for something after, for the time after. The date itself, we'll have to, we'll figure out how to work on that date. But we just need to define something that says, this is before the event, this is after the event. Just like we needed to define a dummy variable for December. December sales were out of this world. So we wanted, December sales were, we got that. We wanted a dummy variable that said, in December, match the data. Show me a value that matches that data. And do that every December. We're doing the same thing here, except now it's for every time period after whatever date we're gonna look at, make that a one. Make X2 a one. So when we look at our data set, it'll be X2 will be zero zeros, will be zeros all the way down until we hit some date, and then that X2 is gonna switch from zero to one. And it's gonna be one all the way down. All right.
I said a dummy variable is, it's a shift, it's going to shift up the line. So we got that before, we got that after. So if this is the trend before, and if the trend did rise, the model, our model wouldn't account for that difference in growth rates. Because a dummy variable is just the shift, and I'll show you how. Remember what this model is. This model is y equals beta 0 plus beta 1 times. Let's ignore the error. Alright. Now we expanded that model. Created 2, x2. x2 is a 0, 1 dummy. We already know that the slope of this line is what? What's the slope of the line?
Beta
1. The y-intercept is beta 0. Right? Okay. Let's account for x2. Before the event happens, what is x2 going to be?
Zero.
So the line for this period is just going to be y equals beta 0. Plus beta 1 time. Correct? Because x2 goes to 0. After the period, what is x2 going to be? 1. So y equals beta 0 plus beta 1 time plus x2 is 1. So beta 2 times 1 is beta 2. It's just a constant. It's just a constant like beta 0. In other words, the slope is always going to be a coefficient of something, of time. But this is just a constant. It never changes. Right? Time changes. This is going to be a number. This is going to be a number. If I add a number to beta 0, what does it do? It shifts it up. So in essence, the line after would be, well, I like to do this. Let me put the two constants together. Why? Because it reminds me that the two things are constant. Plus beta 1 times. What that tells me, again, this isn't algebra, we're not solving for anything, we're not taking derivatives, we're not using the quadratic formula. We just rearrange it and put a parenthesis. Are the slopes of these two lines the same? Are the slopes of this line and this line the same?
B1 times the same. So
what's the slope?
Beta one, in this equation, is the slope. What's the slope in this equation? The slope's the same.
Yeah.
Yes. The dummy variable doesn't change the slope. It's a shifter. So if this was sales, we're not modeling this correctly. In other words, all we're doing is shifting up this line, and that's this equation. And we'd simply be getting beta 0 plus beta 2. It's a shifter. It doesn't change the slope. Let's assume that these two lines are parallel.
So u to t is the dummy variable, which is that. Just a shift.
Ignore u. Dummy variable is going to create two parallel lines. We don't want two parallel lines. We want to see if the slopes are different. We already used dummies to model those shifters for the seasonality. What we want to do is model the difference in this slope, as well as see if the intercept shifters. To do that, we have to create something called an interaction variable. It's a real fancy name. An interaction variable, x3, is simply going to be x1 times x2. That's it. X1 times our simple model. Y equals beta 0 plus beta 1 time plus beta 2 x2, where x2 is 0, 1. After, before. We're going to construct an interaction variable called x3. X3 is simply going to be x1 times x2. It's going to be time times x2. We're just multiplying two things together. That's it. We all know how to multiply. We don't have to do the math. Theta will do the math. All we have to do is tell Theta multiply times times our dummy variable x. And it'll create a new variable called x3. Now, what does this do? Let's see. Now we got this longer equation, right? This is what we had. We added the dummy variable after. X2 is now we're going to call after. And then we're going to add, we added x3, which is after times time. All right, we had to give x2 a name, so let's just call it after. And we're going to call the interaction after times time, which is what it is. Now we're going to do some simple math. Not simple math. It's not even simple math. It's rearranging. Let's see. Before the event, before we hired the social media manager, what is after? What's the value of after? Before. What's the value of after before the event? After takes on two values, 0 and 1. What's the value of after before the event?
Zero.
So if we put zero here and zero here, all this disappears, right? So the regression before the event is just that simple regression equation that we had, that first one. All we're doing is putting a zero in. Beta 2 times zero is what?
Zero.
Zero times time is what?
Zero.
So these things zero out. That's all we're doing. Now after, what are those values? What is after equal?
One.
So beta 2 times 1 is what?
Beta 2.
Beta 3 times 1 is what? Times time is going to be what? Beta 3 time. So we're going to end up with that full equation. But we know that's going to reduce. We don't, the after is just 1, and the after is just 1. So we can just, not zero those out, but 1 those out. Right? And then I just rearrange things to collect them. And I'll do it here. So we've got ln y equals beta 0 plus beta 1 time plus beta 2 after plus beta 3. Well, we already got to that. Beta 2 plus beta 3 time. Right? There's a 1 there that we don't need to show, and there's a 1 there that we don't need to show. The value of that is this. Right? We don't need to show after, we know there's a 1 there. Yeah, I'll show you why. I'll tell you why. But all I did was group things down. I'm going to group the two constants, which we said are the intercept. And then these two things are both coefficients of what? Of time. So I can group those together, beta 1 plus beta 3, and just multiply them times. No fancy algebra. Enough. And that's what we have there. Now, why do I like it like this? Beta 3. Beta 1 we already know is the slope of the line before the event. Beta 3 is the difference in the slope of the line after the event. So if whatever it is we did had any effect, we would expect beta 3 to be something positive, right? To change that slope. So all we have to do is look at the coefficient of beta 3, and that will tell us whether or not the slope changed. All we have to do is look at the coefficient on look at the coefficient beta 3, and that tells us whether or not the slope changed. What was the whole question we wanted to answer before? Did the slope change? Did the growth rate change after the event relative to before the event? Beta 3 is the answer to that question. Beta 3 is the difference in the slope after relative to before. Beta 2 is the difference in intercepts. So in that, it doesn't really matter much. Beta 3 is the main thing of concern. But here's what it should tell us. Let's say that we got that, and then we got this awesome growth rate, that we have an awesome social media manager, the world's best. This is beta 1. This is beta 1 plus beta 3. Now, this is only going to be steeper if beta 3 is positive, right?
Yes.
And for this line afterwards, remember, this is the intercept of the before line. But where would the intercept of the after line be? Think hypothetically. It
it's the value when x equals zero. So it'll be way down here. Beta 2. Well, actually it'll be beta 0 plus beta 2. Just as this was the sum of the slopes, this is the sum of the intercepts. So if this line is steeper, then what should the value of beta 2 be? It should be negative. Why? Because we can just see visually that those slopes have to be deeper, different, and that the steeper line is going to go below beta 0. Okay.
Unless it was such a small change that it was
Unless it
was able to meet within x and y 0 to b 0. On the y-axis, yeah, that little bit of space just between x 0 and the point of b 0 on the y.
Even if it was here.
Yeah, even if it crossed there, there's some growth, but it's very little.
It'd still be negative, though. The coefficient of beta 2 would still be negative, because it's going to be somewhere below beta 0. Unless that line afterwards is flatter, or is negative, then that intercept would be up there. Let's look at the picture. Well, basically, it's that picture. Which is our point, basically, what we said afterwards. We just finished writing. This is an awesome analysis. Why? Because it's answering the question that we started. A very simple question. Are you worth what I'm paying you? Is there any effect of what you're doing on, can we measure the effect of what you're doing on sales, on the growth rate of sales? We get a regression output and we can see these results. Oh, that's that hypothetical. So beta 3 is the difference in the time trends. It's the difference in the growth rate. Remember that dashed line doesn't actually belong there. It doesn't actually exist. It's hypothetically where that intercept would be. Right? Oops. Any questions? Any questions on what we're going to do? It's really a lot simpler than it looks. The Greek, I think, makes it look a lot more complicated. So this is a really powerful model. And statistically, this is how you should do it.
The Greeks made all this. Why is their country in bankruptcy?
What's that?
I said the Greeks made all this. Why is their country in bankruptcy?
The ancient Greeks.
Why did they fail?
Plato and all those guys.
Yeah.
All right, so let's actually construct some of this stuff. Here's data. New data set.
Can't see it.
It's still on the PowerPoint.
That's weird. Ah, this is that thing where it switches, isn't it? All right, screen resolution.
So here's a graph of the growth rate of Merlot before and after the movie Sideways. Doesn't look good. Sideways came out in October of 2004. These are year ending, so this is year ending 2004. This is year ending 2005. It's not, this isn't, there are big discrete changes here. But this seems pretty easy. We want to see if the growth rate before is different than the growth rate after. We're not going to worry about this dip here. We're just going to treat this as one big straight line. And this is the actual data. So we want to run a regression to the model, the pre-growth rate, and then the post-growth rate. Now, visually, what would you say that post-growth rate is?
Zero.
Yeah, what's the slope of that line? It looks like it's zero. So we're just going to run a regression using this methodology to see what the results are. So we know how to do that. We can do... That is real data.
From Bogle?
From who?
From a particular winery? Or the
no, this industry? Is total U.S. sales of all Merlots.
How much did it cost you?
Well, you can see the years there and do the math. That's expensive. That's not cheap. So let's do this. Well, basically, I'm going to construct the dummy first, which is here. I'm going to construct a dummy. Generate, I'm going to call my dummy for 2005. So D2005 equals 1 if the year is greater than or equal to 2005. Replace it with 0 for the years when it's not equal to 1, which is the years before. So those are two separate commands. You've got to run those. There's my gen, there's my replace. Here is my dummy. I could tab it. And we can see it only takes on two values, 0 and 1. The ones are after, the zeros are before. I've got more time periods before than I do after. I was running out of money. Okay, but we know that that's just a shifter. That is, it's just going to cause those lines to shift in a parallel fashion if I was to run a regression using that, right? So we can show that. So let's do this. Show that. Well, we're running out of time. So now I'm going to construct the interaction. The interaction is exactly what I said it is. It, and I'm calling it times D, I'm calling it time D 2005, because it's equal to what? Time times the dummy. We're done. That's it. Constructed two variables, the dummy and the interaction. Now we can run a regression. Right? Constructed that December dummy in the same fashion. 1 if month equals December, 0 otherwise. Now we're constructing an interaction, which is nothing more than the dummy times a variable we already exist, that already exists in the data time. Yeah?
On the replace, right there, D2005, is that a squiggly line? Or
yeah, it's a squiggly line. It could also be an exclamation.
Okay.
Which is exclamation, which is not equal.
Okay.
That's an old command. It still works, but it's an old command. It's like using 2 bits. It cost me 2 bits. Start talking about the good old days. All right, so now I'm going to run, I'm going to create log cases, and I'm just going to run that regression, regress. Everything should be here. Log cases, time, dummy, interaction. This is already yearly data. So let's write this out really quick. Again, these are we don't have to multiply by 12. This is already yearly data, so this is already annual growth rate. So we have cases equals beta zero is the constant, and that is just some number we really don't care much about, at least right now. Plus beta one is the coefficient on time, which is 0.075. Beta two is the interaction, I'm sorry, beta two is the dummy, which is 0.38 D. And then plus the interaction is,
it's actually negative,
minus. Before. What is our equation for before? What is the value of 2005 before 2005? Zero. What's the value of 2005 before 2005? So this term and that term goes to zero, so we end up with 13.7 plus 0.075 times time. Our growth rate, it's already annual. So we don't have to multiply times 12 or anything. Was about, Merlot was growing at about 7.5% per year before 2005. Right?
Just the slope of the line.
Afterwards, our equation is going to be 13.7. And let's group up those constants, right? That's the first constant. What's the other constant? Which is 0.338? Yeah. Plus, let's group the slopes. 0.075. And what's our interaction term?
0.0063.
Minus 0.00. The interaction is the difference in the growth rate in Merlot after the movie came out. So what do we know about the growth rate of Merlot after the movie came out? It fell. Fell by what? By 0.69%. So the growth rate after would be 0.075 minus 0.006. Show these graphically by using our predict command. Predict. Let's call it sales.
No, it's 0.9.
Before. And let's do this. If, we can put as D 2005 exactly equals 0. So let's predict our line for the before period. And then let's predict the after line.
So sales after.
So we're just going to show the graph.
Or after year. Scatter cases for so, the blue line is our actual cases sold, and then the dashed line is predicted. So clearly the growth rate before is greater than the growth rate after. And we can see that that line after is pretty flat. And we have a numerical measure of the growth rates. We know that before was 0.075, and the after is something less than that. Make sense?
Would you show that command one more time?
Yeah.
Which one?
The one you just did to generate that graph.
For the graph, it's just a scatter. It's got lines and stuff. You should have the line commands. Yeah, it's just a scatter. Yeah, so I use the years. It's the same lines we've been using for a while. Line graphs. What's that?
Nothing.
You'll figure it out. Copying do files is like handing in my key. What's the point? Otherwise, I just post the do files, have you run them. Would you learn anything? Probably not.
What are your C and your S's indicating?
The C is for connecting the lines.
Okay.
So connecting, C is for connect.
Connect, and then L for line.
L for line. And S is the symbols. And this, notice that I didn't show the symbols because I is for invisibilize the symbols. That gives you the dash. That was the dash.
What does the hat mean again?
That's just the name I gave it.
I don't understand how it's telling it two lines. Is that because you have two variables?
Yeah, in this case, we've got Ellen Putter are the actuals.
Okay.
Ellen Hat is the predicted. I gave it that name.
Okay.
And then year. So we've just got the y-axis, the x-axis, and then the predicted values in there. You should have a real similar command for the regressions you ran, right? You ran a predicted value in between the two times, in between the x-axis and the y-axis. Yeah. I was just rushing it, and it was, no, not that it didn't run, it was just me rushing it. Those are different. Those are the same commands. It's the one up that I was trying to do by hand that was going to take me forever to do that, which is why I haven't been able to do that. All right, that's it. I think you're going to have to do this, and you're good to go.
Sure.
The one thing that I did in the paper was there is data by price, so under $10, can you see that? I'm clicking on the, or hovering over the variables. There's 10 to 20, and then there's 20 to 40. So I broke it down by price point so we can see a little bit better what's going on, where the effects were felt the most, and yeah, that's it. Use OutRev, we'll be able to compare your results. And for doing this stuff, for adding the constants, for looking at the differences, what would make this really easy? If the data was in what? In Excel.
So yeah, the last graphic out there is showing the pre and the post to the five. So even with, just like all of our other regressions we've been running, it'll generate stuff called gas.